Just Don't Mr. Kalani.
I bet nobody's gonna watch.
Listen, someone's gonna watch.
Is it set on a 15-second delay?
Correct. Yeah.
Ah.
Always gotta have the delay.
Just in case.
Live stream. What am I doing?
Just in case one of them breaks out all the swear words that they know. Bleep them out as you go. Yeah, so you guys are going to need those papers that are up front if you are in the class. So you fill one out per presenter. So if you're going today, you need one. If you're going tomorrow, you need two. Would it bother you if I click my pen your entire presentation?
Maybe.
I'm going to stop presenting to take my pen from me.
Then I'll do that during class when you talk to lecture to us.
Touché. All right. Whenever you are ready, Amina.
Stand by the
podium. Yeah, so I would stand in front of the podium because that's how you have to push through the slides.
Nutria are preyed on by alligators, and turtles, guard, snakes, and birds of prey will eat baby nutria. They face competition with waterfowl and muskrats for space and resources, but they have no problem with that because they can just outcompete them. When it comes to being invasive, the nutria checks all of the boxes. They are crazy good at reproducing, and they gestate only 4 months. They can have 1 to 11 pups per litter, and they're sexually active year-round. This means, in a span of 14 months, they can have 3 litters with up to 11 pups per litter. That's a lot of baby nutria. They become sexually mature at only 4 to 6 months, so they have a long time in their life to have more baby nutria. They have adapted to eat any and all green, aquatic, or terrestrial plants, and they start eating at only 24 hours old. This brings me to the third, damage. When the nutria eat, they go for the roots. When the nutria eat the roots of a plant, it can't replenish itself, which is a problem because a lot of the plants they're eating, they're meant to retain water in marshes and wetland areas, but if there's no more of them, they can't hold that water, so it starts to flood. The nutria will eat any and all things available, but they prefer rice plants, sugarcane, soybeans, three-cornered grass, cattail, bullwood, alligator weed, and duckweed. the nature and their native habitat. The weather cycle was aligned to their eating habits, so it was okay for them to do this, but in the U.S., they're not in their native home, and they don't have any positive impact there. They're only doing harm. My hypothesis is that if the nutria are eradicated from Virginia Beach, then the plant health and rescue will increase in, greatly in the area. So this is a study from Oregon, and the top row was harvests an area with nutria, and the bottom is an area is harvests from an area without the nutria. As you can see, the numbers in the second row are significantly higher than the first row. My eradication plan is to find them, tag them, track them, and trap them. So, the most important thing when finding the nutria is to know where they are. Because how can you trap them and find them if you don't know where they are? So what our plan is to have three treatment zones and three control zones. The treatment zones are where we will trap.
Who was it? Keep going. Ignore it.
In the treatment zones, we will trap and kill the nutria. In the control zones, we will let them be. So we plan to take 125 male and 125 female nutria, find them, sterilize them, and GPS tag them, and let them back out. And then we'll hire 12 research trappers, so then they will use the GPS locations to find them and bring that nutria along with other nearby nutria. So in addition, we'll also be checking to see if the lower population of the nutria will have an impact on their health. So with that, we'll take 5 adult male nutria, 5 adult female nutria, 5 baby male, and 5 baby female nutria, and perform necropsies on them, which are pretty much animal autopsies to see how their health is being affected by the lower population. In addition, we'll also use hair snare traps. As you can see up here, this is an example of what a hair snare trap looks like. So hair snare traps are fake nutria beds. They're designed to look like a nutria bed. Them to come in, but there's a trap in there, so they trap. And so that's where they will collect nutria, but there are also hair snare traps that can be used to help find locations and where they are, because the nutria, they will leave scat and then you'll be able to see where they have been. The hair snare traps with the trap portion, though, they are designed to let smaller animals such as muskrats come in and out unharmed, so it wouldn't be affecting them too much. And then the hair snare traps have shown having 80% detection rate, while just simply tracking for scat only has a 6% detection. This plan is a bit costly, costing $3 million, but we can get this funding from state funding, federal funding, and private companies who are funding similar projects. The Chesapeake Bay Nutria Eradication Project used this technique, and it proved to be very successful with capturing 14,000 nutria from the Delmarva Peninsula, and they're in their final stages of eradication. So our expected results are a higher plant diversity in treatment zones where there are lesser nutria and a lower plant diversity in health and places where there are more nutria and the control zones. In conclusion, the nutria are invasive and they're good at it. They came here to be put on the front market, but they failed to do that. And now they're just damaging wetlands and being detrimental to plant health. And nutria, they also affect us too. When they're eating these roots, it's flooding. We don't want that, but they also burrow infrastructure, which could cause buildings to tumble down. We don't want that either. Getting rid of the nutria will result in happy plants, happy animals, and happy humans.
All right, who has questions?
What influenced you to choose this animal?
I don't know. There was just something about the picture of the nutria. It was calling my name. It was like, pick me. And I had to. I mean, if you look at it, it's just, it has those large orange teeth, which, by the way, are because they have a very high iron level in their teeth, so it causes them to be orange. I just thought there was something about that.
You go.
Do you believe that, like, the $3 million will be, like, reimbursed? Like, do you think that, like, by eradicating them, you're saving yourself money and the $3 million just, like...
Yes. Because with fixing flooding and fixing buildings that will be affected by nutria, that would be quite costly. Also, the nutria do carry diseases. They're very good at carrying diseases. So eradicating them will prevent these diseases.
How big are they?
They're smaller than a beaver and bigger than a muskrat.
I didn't know if they were beaver sized or not.
They're mistaken for beavers and muskrats, but they're different. They're a bit smaller.
Okay. Interesting.
Sorry. Could you go back to your plan page? So when you find them, tag them, trap them, why not, you may have said this, but after you find them, why don't you just trap them then?
Well, because if we let them back out and trap them, we'll also be able to find more nutria, because if they're with their other nutria, we can find nutria.
I have two questions. Can you move back to the second one slide?
Before the thing?
Second slide or second to last slide?
Second slide.
Second slide.
The interactions.
Oh, interactions.
Oh. How do you know this species is the top diamond species? And the second question is, how this species have the high reproductive rate?
So if they have top-down control like that, like, it seems like they have quite a few predators, how come there's such an issue? Because you would think that they would have some sort of control if they have that many predators, right?
Well, they reproduce a lot, and they're already so established, and, like, I mean, so once they're really established, even though there are predators, they're already so large, and since they can reproduce so fast, they can just keep them.
So as you say, they will have the high reproductive rate, right? So how is it affect to the genetic material of this for the next generation? The baby for the next generation, the upstream for the next generation.
So, like, finding them and altering their genetics so that they won't reproduce as much? Like that?
Um,
I'm curious as to what the question is. Can you ask your question again?
Okay, so as you say, they have the high reproductive rate, right?
Mm-hmm.
So how is it affect? How does it affect you the species for the next generation?
So how does their high reproductive rate affect the next generation?
Yeah.
Well, they've become invasive in a lot of places, and they're well established in all of these places. All of these places are considering the nutria problem a big problem.
All right. Great work. Good job. Ready? You can start whenever you're ready. Sorry. Yeah.
Sorry.
second requirement being high adaptability, they're able to adapt in North America specifically because they can adapt to fresh and salt water, and also because they have a free swimming world. And what this means is that even if they are in an area where they aren't able to attach to a site, they can float around and wait until they get to an area that is more prepared for them. And so they're able to adapt in second, third requirement is high reproduction rates, and they fit this category because they produce 1 million outsides in a year. Since they live in dense aggregates, they often are in close proximity to male versions of their species, which allows them to fully expand and fertilize. And also lastly, because they are able to reproduce in extreme conditions, so even when they're mobile, they're able to. The last impact they have isn't necessarily a requirement of invasion, but they pose an economic impact due to the fact that they invade piping systems. Piping systems are often connected to municipal buildings or large power plants, water treatment facilities, and what they do is, again, they create dense aggregates in these piping systems, and they pose something called aquifer, which is degradation of these metals, and that requires repair, which can cost several billion dollars. Since they were, since they invaded due to the fact that there was water in them, also because there were no predators in North America, I hypothesized that if we artificially create a predator and we prevent same voting neglect, then there will be an increase in, or decrease in zooplankton mussels, an increase in zooplankton, an increase in the water quality, and an increase in food web stability. And what this graph is showing is that doing nothing will ultimately put our economy and our ecosystem at a loss, as you can see here, and doing eradication preventative measures will ultimately lose benefit from the ecosystem. Okay, prediction test. So my prediction test has two parts to it, first of which being caught, watched, or stationed. So what these are stations that shoot pressurized water, hot water, at loading hulls. And what this does is it rinses the sea vessels off and forces them to go into a runoff area, which then doesn't allow them to invade the area to trap, which is the whole reason why they are invasive in the first place. This was already done in a smaller lake in Florida, but I plan to do it in Lake Erie, first off because this was where they were first invasive, and also because they are in the higher, they have higher densities here, and it's important to test to see if it would be successful in higher densities, since this is typically how they invade. This will cost $100,025 for three stations, and each station will be able to see 128 boats per day, so in total 385 boats per day. And this is necessary because it will allow us to test for inconsistencies in data and also get a large enough margin to find a mean result. And this will also require runoff monitoring, since we need to see if there are actually a decrease in the amount of mussels being brought to bodies of water. The second part of the test is the use of three chemicals, Zequinox, Earth-Tech QZ, and Procaption. These are our biopesticides and sulfides that damage the digestive linings and also respiration of sea mussels. This was used in a test in Christmas Lake in Minnesota, and they found that it had no result on humans or any other organisms there. It only impacted zebra mussels, so it is safe to use. And I plan to use it in Lake In sum, theater mussels are an invasive species that are easily adapted in areas. They have higher production rates and they biologically pose a threat to ecosystems. Not only that, they pose a threat on humans due to the fact that they can destroy fishing industries and they can also pose an economic impact which can even result in several billions of dollars being used to repair damages that they can cause.
Awesome.
So who do you expect to cover the cost of
this? We're expecting a little aid from the children's states themselves that are in charge that we're testing in, but also private power companies as well, because like I mentioned, this affects like companies like that because of the private systems. So educating them on what could possibly be several billions of dollars in repairs might encourage them to use these sensors.
I'm curious, how did you get the estimations for the cost?
These are the same cost that it costs to put on our test in Florida.
Can you move back to Judy, can you move one slide?
Which slide?
Like, one side that, yeah.
This slide?
No, yeah. I don't remember what. Anyways, you mentioned about three ships, the net damage to the server, right? So how is it, how is it damaged?
One more time. Can you write it?
Oh, no.
Huh?
Sure?
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else? No? Why'd you choose them? Super sharp.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
What is the difference between the palace water and the normal water?
Ballast water.
Oh, that's just the water that comes from the boats. That's pretty from the boats. So, like, you know, when they're traveling, it's like water you can have these bring out. That's just that. So, as the boats are traveling,
anybody else? All right, great work. All righty. So those are our two for the
comic. Are we doing anything else for the next
one? Nope.
Okay, I'll just finish these and I'm doing
these. Yep, so when you guys finish your evaluation forms for people that are in class, you can put them in the front, in the bin up there. Great work today, guys. These are... And this goes for all classes. You guys have done an excellent job with this project. I'm very, very proud of you guys for this. Trust me when I say I've seen college kids do this way worse than you guys have.
Is that done for this block?
Huh?
Is that Alphine? Alphine? Okay.
I've seen that.